motivate them in that way. She's going to get chapel rolling for us here today.
Hey everyone, I would like to welcome you again to chapel. I'm so glad that we are gathered inside on this rainy Thursday. Join me as I read from the Gospel of Matthew. This is Matthew 15, 21 through 28. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Yes, it is, Lord," she said. "Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. Join me as I pray. Lord, we want to come to you today, and first of all, thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us. Lord, you are always pursuing us, and we are so thankful. God, I pray that as we come into this chapel, Lord, and worship and hear your word, I pray that you would open up our hearts, Lord. God, you know, and only you know where each of our hearts are. So God, meet us, and let us see you in all your glory. We praise you, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
All right, if you guys will stand as we worship.
Thank you. All right. Hi, my name is Hannah Chatterton, and I'm a junior here at Milligan.
I'm Jules. I'm a sophomore here at Milligan. And today we have the privilege to introduce you to one of our really good friends. She's part of a family of six, mom, dad, two brothers, and the most important member, Larry, her dog. If she could have any superpower, she would want to be able to teleport. She loves kids, ministry, and a good strawberry milkshake. And she loves a good sunset. So if you can put your hands together with us for our good friend, Ellie Cachiaris.
Yes, that's me. Hi, I'm Ellie. But before I begin, I already spoke with Jeff Moore, but I need you to come up here really quickly, Jeff Moore. Maybe you've had Jeff Moore before. Here's one of our people. Give it up to Jeff Moore. So, I asked Jeff Moore, I said, Jeff, I said, Dr. Moore, do you like potato chips? And you gave me a pretty positive answer, and I know it's chapel time, which means we're about to go to lunch, probably. Hungry. I don't eat that much today. I'm guessing you guys are too. Jeff, are you feeling a little bit hungry? A little bit? Okay. So I actually thought I would be really nice and I actually brought a bag of chips for you. So, unfortunately, I thought that I would give them to you first, but I have to do so. Do you want these bag of chips?
Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes.
Oh, so I was supposed to give you a microphone. He says yes, but I just thought I would. There you go. Okay, you can go sit down. Do you still want it?
I do.
Okay, you can go sit down. Okay, we'll come back to that. Thank you so much. Give it up for Dr. Moore. Okay, so like I said, I'm Ellie. I'm what they call super senior. I've been here for, this is my fifth year. They're telling me to take my mask off. I'm going to do that. I'm very excited for graduation in December, but I'm grateful for this opportunity to be here with you all today. I think I'm excited because we're in this series called Neighbors and Strangers, right? If you've been to chapel so far this semester, you know that. Maybe you didn't. That's okay. But that's the series that we're in. And we've kind of hopped all over the place, pulling from different passages. And we're talking about loving the neighbor as yourself and loving the stranger among you. And so building on that today, we're going to use the passage that Bella read for us earlier from Matthew 15. It's worth mentioning it's also in Mark, but I'm going to pull from the Matthew passage. And it's either, maybe you've heard about it, it's not super common, but it's called either something about like the faith of the Canaanite woman or of the Syrophoenician woman. And just to clarify, that's the same story. The woman, she was nationally a Phoenician and ethnically a Canaanite. But anyway, we're going to see what we can learn today. In my study of this passage, I've been confused, I've been intrigued, but ultimately my heart has been softened a little bit, and I hope that maybe each of you can experience that a little bit today. I know chapel means different things for different people. Maybe you're a freshman, it's your first time, maybe you hate it, and you're trying to get your SFP. Regardless, I think something really cool and special about scripture and biblical truth is that there is something here for everyone. It might not be the same thing, but stick with me. It's going to be short on the students that I relate to you, but biblical truth is important, and I hope that today we can soak in a little bit of that from this passage. So I'm going to read it one more time. And again, we're in Matthew 15, starting in verse 21. It says, "Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, 'Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly.' Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, 'Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us.' He answered, 'I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel.' The woman came and knelt before him. 'Lord, help me,' she said. He replied, 'It's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs.' 'Yes, it is, Lord,' she said. 'Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table.' Then Jesus said to her, 'Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted.' And her daughter was healed at that moment." Okay, so maybe when people read passages, do crumbs or not, or look away, or whatever. That is me too. So basically what's happening here is Jesus is traveling with some of his disciples, right? They're in this region that's outside of their home base area, and they encounter this woman, and she is pleading for help on behalf of her daughter, because she's demon-possessed, but the new claims that she's really suffering. The disciples, they want to send her away, and Jesus' initial response actually kind of seems like he agrees with them. But then eventually, after she persists later, Jesus is like, okay, heals her daughter, the end. And I'm going to be open with you. I had already committed to using this passage for today before I realized how difficult it was going to be to talk about it. Every time I read it, it got worse. It's like, okay, I'm reading it, and there's all these different commentaries and ways of understanding it, and nobody really agrees with each other, actually, about all the details. And I'm reading it, like, I feel uncomfortable thinking about Jesus as a jerk, but it kind of seems like he's being a jerk, that he's silent and she's asking for help. He insults her. But we have to ask questions about what we're seeing, right? Is this just a superhuman side of Jesus that we're seeing? Because he's part of his culture, right? That's influenced the way he thinks. Is the English translation kind of throwing off the way we understand it? I think it's kind of weird to test this woman who's suffering so much so that she can get the compassion she's asking for. There's also different ways to think about it. I'm like, is this just an embarrassing story that we don't want to talk about? And I wish I could tell you that after studying that, I'm like, okay, I perfectly understand and I have a good answer for you all. But maybe it is a troubling text, and I think that's okay, and I don't have all the answers. But I'm going to walk us through like, a few different details that might help us open up some new ways of looking at it. This story is usually used as sort of championing this woman's faith. It's like, yes, great faith. And that's awesome, and I think that's true. But I also think along with our theme of neighbors and strangers, there's a little bit more that we can pull out here today. So whenever we read stories about Jesus, the surrounding community is one of the most important pieces to consider when we're interpreting it, right? In this story, we see that Jesus is talking to the woman, but the community is also composed of the disciples who are listening and also like observing and interacting, right? He's not just talking to the woman, he's actually talking to the disciples simultaneously. So this double interaction is the lens through which we have to understand all this, right? Mostly, I would say that this is actually a huge teaching moment for the disciples, and the woman herself actually has a lot more figured out than they do. And part of, I just want to paint the picture for why this interaction is so crazy. This woman is particularly brave, because not only is she asking for help, I don't know about you, but I hate asking for help. But not only is she asking for help, she's reaching out to Jesus across two huge barriers. She's reaching across a gender barrier, right? She's a female asking a man, but also across ethnic bounds. She's seeking help from a man, and actually with a rabbi, would be considered a rabbi. And what I learned is that rabbis usually didn't even really talk to females, or females even in their own family. So this is a really big deal. And then she's a Gentile seeking the favor from a Jew. And just to really quickly review, Jesus, he's from Israel, he's a Jew, they're God's people. Gentiles are anybody who weren't in that group. And so the Jews, they've been waiting for this Messiah to save them, and they believe that that Messiah is not for the Gentiles. And so there's this kind of like ancient rivalry between the Jews and the Canaanites as well, which is another factor. So she's reaching across this gender barrier, across this ethnic cultural boundary as well. And so considering those things, this is a wild story just to even have her reach out to him, right? So the mother herself, we don't know her name, which kind of makes sense because she's not a popular figure. She doesn't have a lot going on for her. She's like the kind of person you hope doesn't show up to your event. You can't miss out on this dynamic here, right? I hope nobody popped into your head when I said that, but they probably did. And so just go with me. The disciples are literally cringing. They're like, Jesus, like, stop talking to her, send her away. But her role in the story rests on the status that she has. And it's interesting because although she's not Jewish, like I just said, she's a Gentile, she actually seems to have some sort of prior knowledge about who Jesus is, right? There's another place in Mark where people from her region are following Jesus, and they're learning a little bit about him. So it's probably like some passed around knowledge, but she also uses the title. She says, Lord, Son of David, which is something that wouldn't have been naturally known by somebody outside the Jewish tradition. But I think when you talk about the mother, she uses the phrase, she says, Lord, have mercy on me. Not on my daughter, on me. And the pain I think here that's so vivid is from the heart of the mother.
And she's the one with the COVID. She's the one who also needs healing. And maybe you have a parent like this, maybe you don't, but, you know, you've seen an image of a parent-child relationship where, I think of those injuries that I've had throughout college when my mom would drive away from there to come be with me for surgery or something like that. But whether you've experienced that or not, and of course that's less intense, it's the same love of the mother that's pushing her to reach across these boundaries on behalf of her daughter. And it seems that she has a better understanding of Jesus' heart and of his healing power than his own disciples. And in the end, her daughter's healed, but at what cost? Seems pretty humiliating. The disciples coming into this situation, they probably have some pretty negative ideas about women. So when Jesus doesn't respond to her right away, they're kind of like, yeah, because it's everything to do with this. We don't respond to women. this is a different culture, but they're like, yeah, Jesus, that's what we do. It's affirming what they already believe and think about women. And it's pretty clear by their own line in the story, send it away, that they're taking his cues, and they're like, yep, let's get rid of it. But the more you look at it, it doesn't exactly seem like Jesus is on the same page. The setup of the whole thing is that he went on purpose, with purpose, to a region outside of his own, and he actually seems a little bit irritated about his disciples' response to her, because he ends up healing her, right? Which is, like, the disciples ask to send her away, and he ends up healing her. And in doing so, he's starting to challenge these deeper-rooted prejudices that the disciples have toward the woman, right? And we're not strangers to ethnocentrism or prejudice toward other people, right? And when that's challenged, it's uncomfortable, right? And that's the type of situation that we're encountering here. And I think faith is a big piece of this, but it's not the final word. Of course, it's a beautiful story about this woman's faith, but it's also about a larger understanding of compassion and grace that extends beyond our own wounds and breaks down our own prejudices. The disciples, they are soaking this in. There's no explicit lecturing from Jesus about, here's why I did what I did after this passage or anything. But his silence and his response about his healing ministry only being for Israel is a way of showing the disciples what their current theology and assumptions and ways of thinking look like in action. So they seem to be entering the situation, they seem to be sitting pretty comfortable with those. And his response of silence and of saying, hey, this healing power isn't for you, is an accurate way of showing them, hey, this is what you guys believe, and I'm showing you what that looks like. It pretty quickly becomes embarrassing, shocking, when that's thrown in the face of a suffering woman, pleading for her daughter. I think it's pretty embarrassing sometimes when things that we think in our head, when they're demonstrated outwardly, right? Like we've all had that, whether that's a small, silly example or something very serious. If we verbalized the way that we are limited by or other people in our heads, where does that take us? This whole interaction is a pretty uncomfortable exposure of those prejudices in the disciples' hearts, but it was meant to change their vision for their community. What follows is an obligation to face those biases, right? And part of the reason, that's part of this passage actually functions as a turning point for the disciples' mission. When Jesus replies to the woman, he says, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. And so part of the reason why Jesus says this is because I know you think, disciples, I know you think that Gentiles are dogs. And he actually uses a word to soften a little bit, that means little dogs, to kind of soften the insult, but it's still an insult. But he says to the disciples, pay attention to what I'm teaching you here. That's a phrase I want us to take with us today. Pay attention to what I'm teaching you here. This is where the biases have led us. Now what? In the end, Jesus rejects that end result, right? Because he does extend healing and compassion to her. And I think her response is pretty remarkable because she actually absorbs the insult, kind of takes ownership of that dog title, and continues to press into it. And that's a pretty amazing thought. I mean, if somebody insults me, I'm done. I'm going to cry, I'm going to get defensive, I don't know. But she accepts it and continues to press into it. She says, dogs eat food too. She said, yes, Lord, even the dog eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Even Jeff Miller eats crunched up potato chips because they're better than nothing. They're better than nothing. She has this background knowledge that says, I know you've been here and have compassion. Do you not have a crumb of that for my daughter? And she knows that a crumb of that healing and compassion is better than nothing. This response is a deadly blow, to the disciples' prejudices against women, against Canaanites, against Gentiles. This one's way of exhibiting humility, faith, wisdom, persistence, all those things are speaking to that. We know now, and this story helps us see, that God's love has no limits. Jesus says to us, pay attention to what I'm teaching you here. Pay attention. And part of what that means is it includes the questioning of ideas and boundaries that we've inherited, like the disciples, things that we've created, or boundaries to which we've become very attached. It includes catching a larger vision for what Christian community means that's larger than you're doing your field framework, your sports team, Milligan, East Tennessee, or whatever you think of when you think of your community. Jesus affirms here that God's love and God's healing is not constrained by geographical, ethnic, political, social bounds, right? And I think you see an example of what can happen when you have a narrow view of who our neighbor is, right? We're talking about this neighbors and strangers series. The disciples had a pretty narrow view of who their neighbor is, and Jesus helps expand that. But you see that can be pretty damaging when you have a narrow view of who our neighbor is. And so this is an invitation to think about what it looks like to expand that. And in this framework, neighbors and strangers alike fell beautifully into the compassion and grace and love of Jesus, which has the potential to change the way that we see literally everyone. It's important for them because it helps, and it's kind of a marker in their understanding and expansion of the vision for Christian community. And I think in some ways this is kind of like a spiritually forming experience for the disciples. And so today I'm going to give the disciples some SFP points. If you don't know what that is, freshman, you're here because you're earning SFP. And I think it was worthwhile, and I hope that your SFP credit was worthwhile today because you can ask, what am I teaching you here? What am I learning today? I'm going to pray, and then we'll transition. God, I praise you for your limitless life and for the fully accessible healing and love and compassion. Help us pay attention to what you're teaching us today and in this moment in our lives. We invite you to help us identify and remove some of the ugly prejudices and boundaries that we are clinging to right now. Help us expand the way we see our neighbors. We love you. Thank you for your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray through the Spirit. Amen.
Our sermon series right now has focused on neighbors and strangers and how we can expand our view from knowing strangers to loving them as neighbors. At this time, we are going to move into a time of prayer where you get to pray in small groups with those around you. And during this time, we ask that you would pray for healing in areas of division on Milligan's campus. We ask that you would pray for bridges to form in gaps of these areas of division. And we also pray that you will ask that you will pray for healing and relationships. You can go ahead and move into small groups now and begin praying.
when we come. Right? Na 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 na. Just say. Play the like the rhythm of it. No, like play it right now. You're on mute. They're not. Okay, I was going too fast. Like.
All good. No.
I think she has to.
Yeah, she has to close it out.
When do I come in? What verse?
What?
When do I come in?
Verse? Like, fully is the chorus, but with the verse you can do like a little...
The foot?
Can I just do a grip stop?
Hey, tell me when to... Like, lift up your leg whenever the chorus is about to start.
Increase my love, and then
increase my love. I don't need a love.
God, you are so good. You are the God that brings healing, that fixes brokenness, that bridges gaps. We ask that you will help us do the same thing on our campus and in our community. Help us to broaden our horizons and be aware of our own biases in your life. We are so grateful for the ways that you are moving and working in our lives. We love you and are thankful for all that you do. Amen.
All right, you guys will stand for our last song. As we sing this song, I just want it to be like an addition to your prayer. So we're singing about loving others and being that person for the people that are dismissed often. So as you're singing it and as you're praying it, I just ask that you would really consider like who the one is for you today and who the one is for you this week and just moving forward in your life. That's our ultimate goal, is to never stop serving and to never stop loving the people that are unloved. So.